Plugged Inland represents KVCR's continuing interest in focusing on important issues in the inland area. Supported by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, we're looking into innovations and solutions in education as part of the American Graduate Let's Make It Happen. And you can help us make it happen. Call us anytime during the show at 866-367-5827. Or you can send questions or comments right from our website at pluggedinland.org. Or you can email us questions and comments to questions@pluggedinland.org. And you can tweet us at @KVCR.
Welcome to Plugged Inland. I'm Roger Bowman. Tonight we look at additional programs that support our youths who find themselves having difficulties in high school. The wind at the backs of these students, if you will. We'll talk to a foster parent, a youth center counselor, and a person who works with kids that are completely removed from having a normal life. You'll see what I mean in just a second when we ask Sheila Faulkner-Loser about her experiences as a student resource specialist for Riverside City College. Sheila, it's great having you here tonight.
Thank you, Roger. Pleasure to be here.
So what are the age ranges of the kids you work with?
Well, 12-year-old to 21-year-old.
12 years old at Riverside City College. They're taking them younger and younger.
Yes, yeah. When they're earlier, the better, right?
Now, indeed, you actually work with kids that are struggling through high school, right?
Correct.
So how does that intersect with Riverside City College?
Okay. So what we do is we're collaborating with Riverside County Office of Education and the Foster Youth Services and Comeback Kid programs. And what we do is I go into the alternative education schools, and I provide direct educational and transitional services.
Okay, that's it. You've lost me.
Right.
Tell me what it is you do, really.
Okay, what I do in a nutshell. I work with students in high schools who have basically been suspended or expelled from their district schools.
Suspended or expelled.
Right.
So these are the kids that just blew it.
Right, they blew it. Kind of like everyone's kind of given up on them. But I haven't. So what I did, our project is I go in, I meet with these students to find out what it is, what do you want to do after you graduate high school?
So that presumes that you're going to somehow get them through high school. I mean, they're expelled. They obviously aren't thinking about college. They're just thinking about maybe getting back to high school.
Right. A lot of them, that's what they look at. They're like, you know, I can't talk to you right now, Ms. Faulkner. I need to concentrate on high school. But, you know, I do want to do something, but I'm not sure what it is. But I still meet with the student. I come back and see the student every 30 days. And especially looking at the seniors, you know, once I start working with the seniors and they get closer to graduating, then it's like, okay, what is it that you want to do after high school? You want to go to college? Do you want to learn a trade? Do you want to go into the workforce? Or do you want to join the military? Whatever it is, I'm there to assist them with that.
And you actually go to them and visit them?
Yes, I do.
Where?
There's 27 alternative education school sites throughout Riverside. I even made it out to Blythe once, if anyone knows where Blythe is, almost out by Arizona. And I actually visit with the students, I meet with the teachers, see where they're at academically, with their high school plan, with their courses, with their credits, if they're on target to graduate on time.
What's your goal for these kids?
What it is that we look at students who are on goal to graduate, on track, and to reach either their high school diploma, GED, or certificate of completion before the age of 19. Once we've met those students, then I meet with them and then help them transition over into a post-secondary pathway, which would...
What does that really mean?
What do you want to do? Their choices after high school. Do you want to go to, again, a college? Do you
vocational
want to
go, right. school, maybe.
Maybe, I mean, correct.
These kids you're talking about in these alternative education schools.
Yes.
We're not just talking about the comeback kids. You meet kids that are in a lot more difficult situation.
Yes, I do, Roger. I meet kids that are in the Cal Safe program.
And
that's basically kids having kids. You're looking at the teen parents. And some are they're pregnant when I meet them, or they already have their child there in the school when I meet with them. And then also the court schools. I go into the juvenile halls, the Indio Juvenile Hall, Riverside Juvenile Hall, Southwest Juvenile Detention Center, and I meet with those students as well to see, you know, what it is that they want to do after high school.
After high school, they're just thinking about getting out of juvie, I imagine.
Yes, there's a lot on their plate as well. But I'm just there to let them know that, you know, here I am as a supporter. Once you do decide, you know, once you release and once you do decide what you want to do, I'm here to assist you. So, you know, I give them my contact information and I follow up with them as well.
So, all right, let's break that down.
Okay.
You have all these kids that are in, say, juvenile hall
okay.
or some kind of a penal system.
Mm-hmm.
And many of them have committed, you know, various levels of infractions. Mm-hmm. Are they really interested in meeting with you? Are they interested in what you have to say?
You would be surprised, but yes, they are. There are quite a few that are just have actually gone on now. They've been released. They've served their time. I know where they're at. They're enrolled in college. They're doing well. And unfortunately, there are the others. They go back into the system. They commit a crime again. You know, they're back into the cycle. They're at another juvenile hall, and of course, I see them again. And it's, here we go again. Let's start over.
At what point do they start taking your message seriously, that maybe they need to take your path instead of the path that they're on?
You know, I don't, I have a short window when I meet with all the students. I got about a 15-minute window to engage them. And I think that's where I get the buy-in. It's either, you know, here's my contact information, keep it, because I've actually had students that where I thought I've lost track of them, but they've actually called me like several months later. Oh, you know, I was released and now I'm back in California and can you help me? So I think somehow we're making an impact. And
so if they come to you, now my understanding is you're not a teacher.
No, I'm not.
You're kind of a guidance counselor / therapist. Like you said, you even just listen to them.
I just listen, right? I mean, my official title is student resource specialist. So I like to say, you know, I provide students with different resources. You know, what is it that you want to do?
Not a block of cheese, though.
No, not a block of cheese.
What is it that you provide?
Information. And information I find is very valuable and very key to these students. And actually, I bring back concrete information to the students. So say if a student's interested in, say, automotive technology, I bring back information, say, from our school, Riverside City College, or maybe College of the Desert, or some other community college. I bring back actual information and packets for that student, and they take a look at that and see what they want to do.
Would it be fair to say that, you know, you're talking to a student about going to college who's in, you know, juvenile prison, mm-hmm. and they're thinking to themselves, nobody's going to accept me. You know, I've already blown it. I had my shot. I blew it. So you bring all the packets you want, but I have no chance of making it in. Are you saying that you tell them, yes, you do have a chance?
Yes, that's what I do.
Are they surprised?
Yes, they are. I said, because they're like, well, what about my crime? Do I have to? I said, you don't need to disclose anything to me. You don't need to disclose anything on your application. What's happened in your past? Let it remain there. Let's just continue. When we meet as today. Let's move forward. You know, that's how I work with them.
Now, many of these kids have been in and out of the system several times.
Yes.
And these are the kids that we absolutely want to address our society to by building more prisons and letting them stay there. And you don't. You actually want them out and educated and productive.
Yes, exactly. That's what I do. I wake up every day thinking that. How can I change someone's life today? That's why I wake up.
Does it work?
Yes.
It does.
It does, because I've seen results where the students have actually been released. I give them my contact number because I'm not sure when they're going to be released, because probation takes care of that. And then they're released, and then maybe it's 1, 2, 3 weeks later, but they do contact me. And Ms. Faulkner, you know, okay, I'm out now, and you know, can I come meet with you, and can I get enrolled, and can we get started? And you'd be surprised. I'd say 9 out of 10 of the students contact me, and I get them on board.
I've been focusing on those that have committed a crime, but many people are, say, displaced. They're in foster homes. Mm-hmm. Tell me about those.
Oh, that's the group where we're working with students who are, like, maybe they're in group homes, they're with a caregiver, they're with a guardian, you know, basically they're not with their parents, biological parents. So again, it's the same routine. I meet with them, see what it is that they want to do after high school, you know, what path do they want to take, and then I sit down with them and we start figuring out their plan and we go from there.
So really they're displaced, they don't have a biological family, and maybe their support structure is very limited.
Correct.
And they're really interested in learning quadratic equation formulas.
You'd be surprised, yes. And their grade point averages just amaze me. Some of them have like 3.5, 3.6. You know, they just need a chance and an opportunity and someone to listen to them. And then I believe that that's where my role is. I come in, I listen, and I let them know, reassure them, you do have a chance and you can make a difference, and let's move forward in a positive direction. And this, you know, help make a change in society one step at a time.
We've talked with administrators of some of the programs out there that mm-hmm. help the kids get through high school and graduate. Mm-hmm. Deborah Sachs, Comeback Kids, for instance.
Yes.
That's one that you're intersected with. Tell us about that.
I work with the Comeback Kids students. This is the older population now. You're probably looking at about 19 to 21. 18-year-old students. They've decided, okay, I need to come back, I need to finish high school. They may be 10 or 15 credits from graduating, but it's like, okay, then I meet with them. And so what it is, again, what do you want to do once you graduate high school? And, oh, you know, I want to be a chef. I want to go into, you know, cosmetology. There's just so many different options out there, and that's why I enjoy working with all the students, that, you know, I just provide opportunities for them, options, resources. So
do you hand them a packet and say, here's the info, good luck with that?
No. I hand them the packet and we go step by step. Say, for example, it's one of Deborah Sachs, the Comeback Kids student, and they were interested in attending RCC. Once I know the senior's close to graduating, I will go to the school, I meet with the student, I will sit with them in front of the computer, and we'll go online and actually fill out the application, the college application online. And if they have their information with them, say like their social security numbers, if some of them, you'd be surprised how many don't have it memorized. But for those that do have it memorized, I'm able to fill out their financial aid packet as well. So I'm in the schools working with them, and that's the type of resources that I'm able to provide them. So that when they leave school, they're still in high school, but now they know that in August they're going to graduate. They have a confirmation page for application for acceptance to RCC or, like I said, whatever community college, and then their financial aid packet already in place.
I have to say, my son is like pulling teeth to get him to visualize that future. I'd love it if you'd just come over and help him fill out the application.
Sure, I'll be sure to give you a card after.
There's so many. Mm-hmm. You're an example of these support systems that we're talking about. We said at the opening, the wind at the students' backs.
Yes.
I didn't perceive that there were these kind of support systems, from alternative education to your program, available to kids, say, 20 years ago.
It's amazing. Like, I wasn't even aware of, when I first started RCC, I was in the teacher preparation program and was not too familiar with the workforce preparation department as far as their programs. And now that I've been on board, it's just amazing of the support that is there for these students, and as far as like preparing for high school graduation, preparing for the workforce, you know, let's get you to that next step. So it's just incredible what's taking place over the last few years.
Sheila, I'm going to put you on the spot. Tell me, why is it important that we offer all these services to kids that in some cases, not all, just didn't want to do the work, didn't want to sit in a class, study, turn in homework?
Because because it doesn't stop when they graduate high school. Life doesn't stop when you graduate high school. It doesn't stop when you turn 18. There's just so much more out there that I just want to go, you know, into each day meeting with the student and just making them realize, just don't stop at, you know, I just want to get a job just doing this, you know, here and this, you know, there's so much more that this world has to offer. And that's just what I do every day, is I wake up and I just want to go and shout out to the world. Here's this information.
And you talk about that with these kids.
Yes, they do.
Three groups of kids. You have some numbers. I know that you track exactly how many people are in what program and your success rate. Rattle them off for us.
Okay. As of October 2009 through February of 2012, I had identified 722 students. I have met with, face-to-face, like we are, 522.
I thought you were by satellite.
No, but of which 275 were eligible seniors. They had met all the requirements for high school graduation. And of that group, 161 are now enrolled into some type of post-secondary education pathway, or they're doing something after high school.
They're doing something after high school. That right. Really means either college, say a community college, or a vocational school,
correct.
Right?
Or the workforce, or the military.
Okay.
Yes.
These are 161 students, you say?
Yes.
These are 161 kids that, do you think they would have found that way if you and people like you were not there meeting with them?
Honestly, I can say I don't think so, because they've actually said that to me. Like, I gave up, Ms. Faulkner. I didn't know you. Why are you coming to see me? You know, why do you have an interest in me? What do you want to do? You know, thank you for having an interest in me. I wouldn't have known about this had you not come to see me. So I believe it's an important project that I'm part of.
It's actually an amazing tapestry. Mm-hmm. That we have of this, what I call the safety net. And I don't mean government doles out money to them so much as I'm talking about people that are invested in the success of our community members. I know a lot of kids are simply immature. They don't realize how much they're hurting their future when they're 15 and 16 and making bad choices.
Correct. And I meet with that group as well. So they're part of that group, and they're not quite ready yet, but that's okay. I still meet with them once a month and come back and visit, and I just keep providing information, feeding it to them slowly but surely. And I know one day you'll take a look at it. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but you'll look at it.
And they don't think you're trying to sell them something join, you know, a cult or anything?
Not at all. Actually, when I meet with the students, you'd be surprised because, unfortunately, like I said, some are through probation. And it's like when they meet with me and they're called to the different offices, you know, at the court schools and at the community centers, it's like, so who are you? Why do you want to see me? What did I do? What did I do wrong? And I'm like, no, you didn't do anything wrong. This is who I am and this is why I'm here. And you might have mentioned to your counselor or your teacher that once you graduate high school, you want to do something. So I'm that person that's here to get you to that next step. And it's like, oh, okay, yes. Well, you know, I have an interest in, you know, like I said, cosmetology or some other type of trade, or I want to go to college, I want to be a veterinarian or something like that. So
not every kid you meet with is going to turn their life around and diligently get through high school and on to that post-secondary pathway that you talked about. Instead, they are going to just do what they've always been doing. Mm-hmm. Does that frustrate you?
It did in the beginning, but I just realized that I see as many students as I can, but I see one student at a time. And each student just has a story to be told, and I'm just there to listen. Some will listen to what I have to say, some won't, but that's okay. At least, you know, I'm taking it one student at a time.
Do some of them reject meeting you, or maybe if they haven't done what you'd hope they would do, they get embarrassed and don't want to see you again?
No, actually, I've got a perfect track record with that. So no one's gotten upset that I've asked to see them, or, you know, why are you seeing me? So far, so good.
Wow, you're meeting them at the alternative education centers.
Yes.
So what happens to the kids that are out of the system completely?
Well, that's a good question, because there are some that by word of mouth through that I meet with the students, say at the alternative education centers. And then they'll say, oh, you know what? I have a brother, you know, who's like 19 and he's just kind of out there not doing anything. Maybe he can talk to you, you know. So we just try to keep that connection, that line of communication open. So I said, sure, just give him my card and I can refer him to the appropriate individual. You know, just get him here. Just, you know, just so we can, you know, have him on board and keep them moving in a positive direction as well.
You talked about CalSafe, and that's the kids having kids.
Right.
And we were talking, you see a lot of teenage mothers.
Yes.
And now fathers. You're seeing more fathers.
Yes. There's been a big influx in fathers the last year. So that seems to be that they're building that support network within the school itself, where you have mom, you know, father, and then the baby. Sometimes the young ladies are pregnant, and sometimes they've already had the child.
And when they've already had the child, mm-hmm. they're at the alternative school mm-hmm. with the child?
With the child. And they're sitting with me directly like we are, cross sitting with me with the child. And I said, well, how old is your daughter or your son? And we're going to get you enrolled at RCC2. And that kind of, you know, breaks that kind of tension with them. And let's see. And what's important, though, Roger, to mention that with the CalSafe students is that once I do find out where they are interested in attending, whether, you know, it be a college or whatever program, I make sure that whatever they've decided, that I look for childcare for that student, to make sure that is, because that's a big concern of theirs.
Right.
If I go to school, you know, what can I do for my baby? Because some of them do not have that support network at home where they need, you know, they have a babysitter. So I have to find out, like from our colleges, the early childhood study programs, do you have a daycare? What's your, you know, what age limit are you accepting the children? You know, what are you looking for? So I put those applications into place as well. That's real important for the CalSafe students.
Okay, good. Now we have an email. Regina of Grand Terrace, what do you do if the kid isn't interested in your program? Do you leave them alone or do you try to convince them? Give me a fairly quick answer.
Oh, if they're disinterested?
If they're disinterested.
Oh, then that's a very short visit. that's a 5-minute
visit.
Does
that happen?
It has, where they're disinterested, but I pretty much, they don't really have too much to say. They're just kind of sitting there because they've been asked to the office.
So you don't try to sell them?
Nope, don't try to sell them. Just give them my card, just give them my phone number.
And let life turn their
pretty much
around.
And I'll see you, and I'll be
all
back
right.
in a month.
You know, the reason for all these programs is to get kids through to graduation, which, as we've learned, is the most important factor affecting their future prospects. Last week, we highlighted a startling successful program, Bright Prospect, out of Pomona. So let's take a look at some of the parents talking about what it took to get their kids to that graduation point.
Thank you. It's a really good program, and I would encourage many students, you know, to join the program. It's been really good for her. She's been part of the program for about 4 years, and it's done a really, it's helped her grow a lot with all the events and the cultural field trips that they've gone to. She really grew a lot and fast, and it really helped her. It really helped her a lot, you know, to really choose. You know, it gave her, it opened, it gave her a broad, you know, choice on to look at other colleges instead of just looking at her local colleges. And I thank God, you know, that she was able to go to the college of her choice. She'll be going to Haverford College in Pennsylvania. And I just want to thank Bright Prospects for all that.
We are Alberto's Guadarrama parents. We are so happy for him to graduate today. Bright Prospect was an amazing program. It helps a lot to my son. He's going to UC Santa Cruz. Bright Prospect did a lot of good things for him. He was very excited to be part of the program, and he find a lot of friends. He find the correct ways to fill it out all the papers, to look for help that he really needs. So we are very, very, very happy to be part of the program.
Hola, buenos días. Mi nombre es Margarita Méndez. Soy mamá de Hilda Méndez. Estoy muy orgullosa porque mi hija ya se graduó de la high school y próximamente se va a UCI. Y con la ayuda de Bright Prospect y de otros programas que la asesoraron, la ayudaron a tomar una buena decisión. Quiero agradecer a todo el grupo de Bright Prospect por haberla apoyado. Aunque mi hija entró este año, no tuvo la oportunidad de estar anteriormente.
It really helped us, and I really recommend this program to anybody that wants to join it, because they do help you on achieving your goals and helping you going on to college. Thank you.
What Bright Prospects has meant to us is the connection that our child has had to colleges where the schools have failed or have struggled. As all these schools are now experiencing cutbacks and budgets, it's harder for them to get these kids connected with the colleges and schools. And that's where Bright Prospects helps to pick up the pace.
I'd like to introduce a new guest, Issac Contreras, who works as an education counselor at the Rubidoux Youth Opportunity Center in Riverside. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure having you. Thank you.
So what is it that you do? What is the Rubidoux Opportunity Center?
The Rubidoux Opportunity Center is an education and job training program. And what we do is we get a lot of youth that are disconnected, which means not in school, not working, maybe just couch surfing, and get them into our program and, you know, educate them, get them back into high school, get them to get the GED, give them some job training, and, you know, just give them some motivation to get back into life.
You piqued my interest with the couch surfing, but before we get to it, there was a tweet that we got, and I want to acknowledge the person, KWolf22, tweeted about our last guest, getting into college can be hard enough without the work that you do. It's nice to know that you're there to help the foster kids. So, Sheila, thank you very much for helping the foster kids. Now, you mentioned the couch potatoes.
Yes.
Basically. How old are we talking about?
We're looking at youth that are ranged from like 16 up to 21.
So, and they've just dropped out of the system completely.
Dropped out of the school, you know, just thought it was something else, something better to do, maybe just hang out.
School's not. Xbox.
Yeah, Xbox. No support at home, mostly, for the most part, you know. You know, just couldn't make it through school. It can be also a part of, you know, a disability, a learning disability, maybe something like that. Just forget it. You know, some things can be also like, you know, fighting from school, those kind of things, expulsion. So why should I go to school? So,
a lot of the kids that you work with, though, are members of gangs.
Correct.
In fact, the vast majority. Is that right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So you're working with the gang youth that are out there.
Correct.
Now, the perception is that we just want to lock them up and pretend they don't exist. But you can't do that.
No, there's no way. You know, some of these kids, they deep down inside, after you, you know, kind of get to know them and really know what they want to do, they don't want to stay in these gangs. They all know that gangs lead to either death, you know, drug addiction, or incarceration. So definitely we're there to help them, to support them, to not judge them, you know, give them a different way of life and help them understand that there's a lot more to life than just choosing the gang lifestyle.
Now, is it true that some of them want out of the gang? I mean, it seems to me like you're out there kind of dangling the U.S. liberty kind of political asylum to the Soviet defectors, of the Olympics and such.
Definitely.
Trying to get the little trickle of people that might come over and join the, leave the dark side and come to the correct Jedi Knight side.
Right.
Am I wrong? Are there a lot of them that want out?
Yeah, I think a lot of them do want out. They just don't know how to. And I think for the most part, even though they know it's wrong, it's easier to still keep on doing what they're doing. It's something that, they believe, this is all I got. This is all, this is my life. It can be generational from, parents to uncles, aunts, and just affiliated neighborhood, product of the environment. My friends are doing it, so it also brings like a sense of belonging to them too, even though it might be superficial or...
The gang does. You're talking about the gang.
Talking about the gang, correct.
Bringing kind of a, I've got your back family there.
Right.
So do they not have that at home?
For the most part, they don't. A lot of times they're just, like I said, they're disconnected. There's no positive role model in their life. Especially in the Rubidoux area, there's a high dropout rate and unemployment rate. So there's nothing else going on. Why not just join a gang? I see fast money. I see, the popularity, the status, things like that, that keep them interested into something like a gang lifestyle. So, and that's why we're there, to just try to show them there's more to it than just that lifestyle.
It seems like this idea of fast money, you may be able to get some money when you are not incarcerated, but you're not earning a lot when you're incarcerated.
Right.
And I don't know of a lot of gang members that stay out of prison.
Right. So, I mean, for the most part, it's just the luck of the draw. I mean, that's what they do. Sometimes it doesn't really matter if they get caught or not. They're used to going in and out. Once they get used to that recidivism rate, it's just, they just keep going in and out like it's nothing. So,
So finally, let's say they have a family that they care about. They don't want to burden their family as much. I'm assuming that's probably a driver for turning their life around. Maybe we're talking kids that are too young for that level. But if they want out, how much pressure is there from peers or gang members or even family to stay in, to not go your path?
That's a good question. A lot of times when they are, stuck in a gang, there's definitely some consequences to try to get out. I know that for a fact. Other things, it's just, I truly think if they do make that effort and they do want to do something better for their life, there's a lot of support that could come from the gang and say, I respect that you are trying to change your life. You're trying to do good, either for maybe a child that you might have or just for yourself,
Wouldn't that require the other gang members, introspectively decide that what they're doing isn't good also and wish them a better life? Do they do that?
Yeah, I think for the most part, they'll probably get a little heat from their fellow gang members and stuff like that. But for the most part, if they're coming and they're putting effort and if they're going to do it full force and really put effort in their life and really change their life, that's what the Rubidoux Opportunity Center is there for, to help them do stuff like that.
So you have your master's degree.
Correct.
And you graduated with your bachelor's from Cal State Fullerton?
Correct.
So you're totally removed from these guys. They look at you and say, you don't even have any idea what my life is like. Right or wrong?
Yeah, for the most part. But once I start getting to know them, and I think the most important part about what I do as a worker is creating that relationship. I think once I create that relationship and tell them a little bit about my history, about the things that I've been through, broken home, not knowing my father, stuff like that. Some of the drug addiction that I dealt with and really turning my life around, it kind of gives them a sense of hope that if I can do it, why can't they? So I think once I, talk to them in their language, and I think the most important part is, definitely creating that relationship with them and knowing that I'm there for them and not in a judgmental way, I think that it does go a long way.
So you actually grew up in circumstances similar to theirs. You know a little bit about what they're going through, and they sense that. I imagine that helps you foster that relationship that's probably very important for establishing credibility.
Yes. So I do, for the most part, know a big portion of that. Some of the choices I made in my early adulthood was also, not so positive. Like I said earlier, I was, I overcame a drug addiction. I turned my life around. I started making better choices. I'm like I said, I'm there to help them guide these young men and young ladies also to a better part of life.
You're obviously articulate. You're smart. How many of the people that are out there joining gangs are smart versus how many of them are just, you know, dumb. It's where kids that can't make it through school go because they're dumb.
You know, it's amazing. It's a good question you say that. You know, a lot of these kids are witty. They're really smart. They know the ins and outs. And what I try to do is I try to focus them in that in a positive way. You know, these kids, you know, they are, no, get me wrong, there are some kids that come in that we assess in our program that are actually, you know, educationally sixth grade level at 18 years old, so on and so forth. But for the most part, you know, they are very smart. They, you know, if they can really focus that energy in a positive way and, you know, show them that there is a way of doing it, I mean, you know, they can, you know, make big things in their life.
I'm one of those believers, those kids with special needs aside, that most of the people that we see that appear to us to be dumb, they are either dumbing down their use of the English language, street vernacular perhaps,
right. Or
they just haven't stayed in school enough to be able to talk broadly about a variety of subjects that we all talk about.
Mm-hmm.
So what we perceive as dumb probably in many cases isn't, as you say.
Right. I think so. I mean, if you look at you know, things they're doing out there, negative or positive, some of the things, the thought process that go into some of their decisions, I'm like, ah, this guy's really smart. He knows what to do. Like I said, why can't we just turn it this way and help them, you know, make better choices in their life with education, with maybe, you know, job, you know, going up job placement, stuff like that. You know, it's
really have to get a bulldozer behind them and kind of force them through, or how many of them are really looking for somebody to come along and say, I can help you take a different path?
For the most part in our program, I think so. A lot of them are coming in because it's not a mandated program. They're coming in. They know there's opportunity there for them. I believe that they want to come in because they feel they need to do a change in their life. Whatever they're doing is getting old. It's burned out. They're seeing their friends, their other fellow gang members just going in and out of prison. Maybe someone died here and there. So I believe that they know deep down inside that there's something better for them, that they really want to make that change. So, and that's why we're here for them.
All right, so let's jump out and let's take a call from Jasmine of Whittier. Jasmine, you're on the air. What's your question? Jasmine, you with us? Okay, lost your chance.
Okay, all right.
Yeah.
Hi, Jasmine. Thank you for joining us.
Hi.
Did you want to say anything?
Yeah, I just want to give a shout-out to my dad. I'm very proud of him, and I love him very much.
Thank you, Jasmine.
The whole family is very proud of you, Dad, and I admire all the work you do with the youth, and I'm very proud to be your daughter.
Thank you. Thank you, Jazzy.
Very cool. Okay, so tell me about what it is you offer these students. What kind of programs do you offer?
Okay, with the Rubidoux Youth Opportunity Center, we give them, you know, education and job training program. What we do is we get these youth, for the most part, maybe dropped out, disconnected from school, maybe, you know, aged out of school. We get them back into school through the Comeback Kids program that's also one of our partners through RCOE. We also give them a 100-hour job training program. So what we'll do is we'll go to a local auto parts store, and we have a youth that's interested in maybe pursuing the auto industry. And we'll tell the auto parts store, you know, hey, I got this young man, say for instance, Mario, and he wants to, you know, learn a bit more about the auto industry. Can you train him? We'll pay them. And, you know, hopefully after that's done, after his 100 hours are over, they'll just hire him right on. So it's basically, you know, a job training internship where there's a possibility of getting hired on permanently. So
for the auto parts store, it's an intern. It's somebody who is motivated. It's a free 100-hour employee.
Correct.
And for the student, prospective employee, you're paying him, and so it's a job.
Yeah, definitely. And it's also not only that, it's also a resume builder. They get that experience. They learn the world of work. They get that, you know, that basic soft skills, being on work on time, clocking in, clocking out, greeting customers, some of those things that a lot of these maybe so-called, you know, gang-related youth are just missing in their life. So
let's talk about the culture of gang-related youth.
Mm-hmm.
There's a big system of honor. You probably don't know. I was on a jury once for a Moreno Valley case. It was gang versus gang violence.
Okay.
Some shots, some assault rifles, some, you know, multi-day tit for tat, and it was all about umbrage and honor. Mm-hmm. And that seems to be part of the culture is you can't offend me, anything I'm affiliated with, my colors, my sports teams. How do they develop a complete turnaround in the job market to where they just roll with the normal, you know, banter and politics that is employee life?
Yeah, definitely. It's definitely not a overnight sensation. It's definitely takes some work. We have a part of the program also offers a pre-employment portion to it. So we prepare them with interview skills, how to dress, how to walk, how to talk, how to even, you know, write, even some of the penmanship, you know, get that kind of straightened out. We also work with youth that are, you know, that just don't even know how it is to be in the world of work. We have them go in. We take them, you know, job searching out in the community, have them deliver the resume, have them talk to maybe a potential employer to actually maybe perhaps get hired on. So it's definitely a work involved into it. So, yeah.
You know, one thing I want to mention, you've talked about Rubidoux, and we've kind of concentrated on that because obviously you're from Rubidoux Youth Center.
Correct.
But there's peer youth centers throughout the area. In fact, a couple of your peers are located where?
We have also one located in Hemet and another one located in Lake Elsinore. So we cover some of the different regions of Riverside County, so some of the areas where there is definitely a need for, you know, youth employment and stuff like that. So education, wherever we feel, you know, where we can service these youth. And it also branches out to, you know, surrounding areas, Riverside. We do Lake Elsinore, Hemet, San Jacinto. We also do Wildomar, some of the other areas around the surrounding centers. So.
Any success? How successful have you been?
I think there is plenty of success, actually. I mean, a lot of the times as a youth counselor, youth educational counselor, or just a case manager, a lot of our stuff is time released. So they might not get it actually, you know, the next day, but later down the line, we plant that seed. They know we're definitely an opportunity for them. We see a lot of youth that, you know, maybe run from our program, I don't want to do this, but give them about a year or so, they come right back. They know where it's at. They definitely do. So,
you know, that brings to mind, and I just want to point this out. A lot of us, I think, in the community are unaware of these kind of organizations and the work you do. And I actually find through this process of these shows, it's been very gratifying to discover that you're out there. And other than the juvenile system that punishes them and the police, we all mm-hmm. want more police on the streets, that we're out there also trying to pull them in a different direction. If it weren't for you and your organizations, I don't know where these kids would go.
That's definitely correct, Roger. I believe this is definitely a building block for them. It helps them transition into adulthood for the most part. And the center in Rubidoux is also more of a community center, so it's definitely a safe place for them. You know, we're centrally located between two rival ethnic gangs out in Rubidoux. So a lot of these kids that come there, it's a safe place. We have a basketball gym there. We got computers. We got just positive role models, mentors. People that really have passion for you. So it's definitely a place for them, you know, that they can call home.
Do you get to know them personally?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. Some the way the program works sometimes, if they're not showing up and they're on my program, on my caseload, we go knocking on their door. So definitely we get to know them. We get to know a lot about them. With everything and, you know, building these youth up, it definitely takes a group effort. Home, if there's anybody at home that we can relate to help them get them in here and help them be successful, that's definitely a plus for us. So we definitely know a lot about them. We get in depth with them. We engage with them, you know, and we just definitely create a good relationship with them. So,
all right. You know, we have another call. Let's go out to Gloria in Ontario. Gloria, you're on the air. What's your question?
Hello.
Hi, Gloria.
Hi, this is Gloria from Ontario. I just want to know if there's any type of house calls that you would make with a child if they don't want to go in. I have three stubborn teenagers.
In other words, you do house calls.
Do we do house calls? Yes, I do. If they're in, like I said, if they're in our program, Gloria, and they are, you know, part of our caseload, we do go to the house. We do, you know, get them to come in for the most part, and we have to work with them, and we have to, you know, also get the household on our side too to help them, give them the push. But for the most part, I mean, the kid has to show willingness. It definitely has to. I mean, we can't force them. We can't really make them. You know, come in by twisting their arm or doing something like that. But, you know, if once they're in our program and they, you know, are doing what they have to do to get in, we have to go out there and really help them out with that. So.
And when you say the program, what you're really doing, you're a youth center with a basketball court.
Correct.
But what you're really doing is pulling them into an education system.
Definitely. An education system and a job training program. So, you know, once the kids come in and they do sign up for our program, there's definitely plenty of opportunity for them.
Okay. I'm going to go out to another call. Denise from Riverside, you're on the air. What's your question? Hi, Denise.
Hi. Yeah, I have a question for Mr. Contreras. As a mother of seven children myself, four being teenagers and older, I was wondering what's the best piece of advice that Mr. Contreras could give me to ensure that my children do not end up in this kind of a situation?
Good question, but I'm going to ask you to make your answer short.
Okay, yes, good question, Denise. I think you just got to show them love. You got to create that relationship. I mean, if you're not spending that time with them and actually, you know, creating that relationship with them, the person next door, whether it be a guy or girl, will show them that time and effort. So definitely, you know, spend that time with them, show
them
the love.
That's the thing that's missing from a lot of these kids in your view.
Definitely, definitely. You got to create that relationship, and you definitely got to stay connected.
Now let's take another moment and look at some of the celebratory graduates that we saw before. And when we come back, we'll have a foster parent tell us his story.
I just want to thank Bright Prospects for this for their program. It's really helped my daughter, Julianne.
Bright Prospects is an amazing program, not only for the students, also for parents. Every time we need help, we go and look for help, and they are always there for us. So thank you so much, Bright Prospect, for helping us and be there for our students. So that's all that I can say. Thank you very much.
Pero gracias a eso, mi hija se animó bastante y quiero invitar a los demás papás para que inscriban a sus hijos, los apoyen, los ayuden. Y pues sin la ayuda de nosotros y de los programas que hay, no sería posible de que nuestros hijos fueran al colegio. So, yo les invito a los papás que apoyemos a nuestros hijos para que tengan un futuro mejor. So, gracias al programa de Bright Prospect y gracias por su apoyo y toda su orientación. Felicidades, hija, por tu graduación.
I am a proud parent of Leslie Suniga. She went to Pomona High School. She graduated this year. I really want to thank the staff for Bright Prospect for helping her out. She is going to college this year, and I am very, very grateful for whatever they did to her because it worked. It worked, and she's an excellent student, and I really love this program.
Soy la mamá de Jasmine Rodriguez. Ella se graduó de Pomona High. Y le quiero dar las gracias al programa de Bright Prospect, que más que un programa es como si fuera familia. Y me gusta mucho cómo tratan a los niños. Muchas gracias.
They have been very supportive. They're with her, they email her. They're like their second family, and we really appreciate it. They keep an eye out on her. And we're just very blessed. We're very thankful for the program.
I'm the parent of Josephine Bradway. I just want to say how thankful my wife and I, or my family, are to Bright Prospect for helping Josephine to achieve his goal. If it wasn't because of this program, we would have run into a lot of roads that we really wouldn't know what to do. So we want to thank all the personnel that work with Bright Prospect in helping all these students achieve their goals and helping them to, you know, get to, encouraging them also to get to their goal in getting into a college to brighten their future.
Plugged Inland represents KVCR's continuing interest in focusing on important issues in the Inland area. Supported by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, we're looking into innovations and solutions in education as part of the American Graduate. Let's make it happen. And you can help us make it happen. Call us anytime during the show at 866-367-5827. Or you can send questions or comments right from our website at pluggedinland.org. Or you can email us questions and comments to questions@pluggedinland.org. And you can tweet us at @KVCR.
You know, those videos were highlighting the program that we talked about last week, Bright Prospect. But I'm certain that had we been there, we could have gotten so many testimonials from the Gateway to College parents and the Comeback Kids parents and so many of the other programs, the March Mountain High School parents from Moreno Valley. And now I'd like to talk to a foster parent. Many kids get displaced from their biological parents for many reasons. Many of them bounce around from home to home and have trouble adapting. And for them, focusing on algebra has got to be a very low priority in their life. So tonight I want to welcome a foster parent who's going to give us his perspective. I'd like to welcome you, Juan Lopez, for joining us tonight.
Thank you for having me here. It's a pleasure.
So tell me, first, what's the name of your son?
His name is Anthony Duran.
And what program is he in?
He is in Gateway to College with Riverside City College.
He's in the program now?
He's in the program right now.
Where is he in the program?
He is taking his last classes to finish his high school diploma and working in college courses towards his associate's degrees now.
No kidding. So he's already moved. For those that didn't see the program, Gateway to College first runs a semester where you kind of get caught up in the high school level.
Correct.
And then it has you go into college classes where you earn college credit while also finishing the credits for high school.
Correct.
And he's in those college classes.
He is taking his last couple of classes in order to get his high school diploma at the college level.
Are you proud of him?
I'm really proud of him.
So you're not his biological dad.
Correct.
So how did you come to be his foster parent?
It was 3 years ago when I came in touch with him. He, after leaving on the streets for a year by himself, which it was difficult for him to focus on school, so he had to drop out in order to survive. He came in contact with me with his brother, and they asked me if I could be the foster parent. I'm single, so it was really difficult for me because at the moment I was going through my graduate program, plus working a full-time, so it was a really big responsibility.
So let me ask, they just came to you. How did you know them? What made them think of you?
His brother worked with me through the Summer Youth Opportunity Program, through workforce development, through RCC, and we became really good friends and he came in touch with me and asked me for help. And it was either to help him with his brother or leave his brother out there on the streets.
So I have this perception that foster parents are people that just want to help kids, so they sign up with the state or city and then they get screened and then eventually they get connected with a child they don't know. But that isn't at all what happened in your case.
No, it's not my case.
They came to you and you didn't intend to be a foster parent.
No. After he came and asked me if I could be, well, the reason he asked me to be his foster parent is because we went back into the system to social workers, and they told him he had no choice because he was already almost 18. And they told me that they told him that his only option was to go back into a group home or he would have to find someone to foster him. And that's the reason he asked me, because he didn't want to go back into a group home.
So you were already working in the field of youth development, and clearly that means that you are interested in helping kids. But I must imagine that having them come to you and say, hey, be my foster dad, is a little like having a daughter that announces, gee, dad, I'm pregnant now, and oh, by the way, you're going to care for the baby, and I'm going to leave.
Correct. It was a little different the way it worked for me, but he's been living for me 3 years now. I'm really proud of him. He's almost finishing his high school, almost 30-something units of college credit, and he's working towards his associate's degree. He works, and he's doing everything.
What have those 3 years been like?
It's been a really good 3 years, a lot of learning experience for me. Like I said, I'm single, but he's my kid now.
Now, is that the television answer, or are you telling me just the...
No,
what,
that's
did
for
it
real.
Have its ups and downs?
It's been, he's a teenager. Like every teenager, there's ups and downs, but I'm really proud of him. I learned to love him as my own biological kid, and that's how I see him, as my kid.
And they made a good choice in getting you for their dad.
I hope.
So obviously you were able to not only get him a home, because he was homeless, living
Correct.
In a car, right? Was it in the car?
Well, he was living wherever he could.
Oh, literally, just crashing anywhere.
Crashing anywhere.
And not only did you give him a home, but you got him into a program that is not only getting him through high school, but getting him into college.
Well, the only reason I got him into regular high school, which was just problems. Every day I got a call from the teacher from the school saying that Anthony did this, Anthony did that. So we look into
Gateway. These are behavioral problems we're talking about, right?
Correct. Then we look into Gateway to college because I heard about it through my work because I work for Riverside City College. And I talked to him about it, and he's like, okay, let's go see what is it about. We went to the orientation. He seemed interested about it. He saw it as a challenge, and he went through all the process, and he likes it because it's a challenge for him. I think on the regular local school, they were not challenging him enough. And in Gateway, they put him to work. They have to meet their goals, and if they don't meet their goals, they're in trouble with the school and with me.
So you don't get calls every day saying behavioral problems?
No.
You mentioned, sure, he's being challenged, but you're taking a kid who wasn't thriving in the regular high school system, and at that point, I'm not going to put words in your mouth, you tell me, were you then like second-guessing the decision to become the foster dad?
Not really, because we have good communications. I believe we have good communications. We talk about it, and he said, honestly, this is not being challenging. It's not challenging for me. I want the goals where I'm going to be challenged, and I'm going to be forced to do something. At the regular high school, I don't really do anything. I just go and sit there and see what happens throughout the class, but I'm not challenged. I want to be challenged.
Throwing him into college classes has worked. He's succeeding in Gateway to college.
He's, like I said, he's 2-3 classes away from getting his high school diploma and with 30-something units.
That must be very gratifying for you.
It is.
So what is it like? Well, first tell me, how long did it take him to see you as his dad? Did you have any trouble either getting him to accept you as a loving father figure or even as an authority figure?
It was kind of hard because he was, like I said, he was living on his own. He has own different ways of saying things, and I have my own different ways. Yeah, at the beginning it was kind of ups and downs, but now he sees me as a father, and I see him as my kid, and everything is good so far. He is working, he has a job, he goes to school, and he got a job opportunity by going through Rubidoux Youth Opportunity Program. So those programs really work.
And we didn't even bring you on for that.
No.
I mean, that's just talking about the tapestry of the support systems out there. We said the show is about the wind at the students' backs.
Yeah.
And you are, in this case, that wind. So you know what? We're going to run out of time, and I just want to ask you, would you recommend becoming a foster parent to these kids to others?
I do recommend it. The only thing, you have to do it for their kids, not for the money or whatever it is behind it. Do it if you really want to help the kids, because the way I see it is with Anthony's situation and the stories he tells me about his previous foster parents, that's only going to hurt them. So if you really want to do it for the kids, go for it. It's a good experience. You learn a lot of things from the kids. You learn to love them. Don't do it for the money. Do it for the love of the kids.
Thank you so much, Juan.
No.
And you know, that's all the time we have tonight. I'd like to thank our guests for joining us, Sheila Faulkner-Loser, Issac Contreras, and Juan Lopez. Next week, we want to look at the young teachers that are out there choosing to teach during these challenging times in education. Why would they make that choice? We'll find out. I'm Roger Bowman. Thank you for watching Plugged Inland.